So what we see here is a significant, I mean significant amount of income being generated from this investment. And given these results, it's clear to me that I would never utilize this ETF for the purpose of but instead potentially utilize it for the purpose of what's up, you guys? Welcome back to the Average Joe Investor channel, where we talk about all the different ways to generate cash flow in your portfolio. Today, we're talking about an investment that's highly controversial, and that is from YieldMax, the YieldMax Coin Option Income Strategy ETF. Ticker symbol CONY, or CONY as I like to call it. YieldMax ETFs are known for having significant income results, and these investments are anything but normal. So the goal of this video is to make sure we understand exactly how this investment derives its income, how it specifically operates, and then I built out a spreadsheet naturally to break down the results since the fund launched and have some key takeaways based on those results. So the CONY YieldMax Coin Option Income Strategy ETF, which is quite a mouthful here, they have a distribution rate right now of 110%. And we'll certainly unpack that. It's based on the underlying results of the coin stock, C-O-I-N, and we're gonna scroll down here. Here's a result. Here's a look at all of the historical distributions since the fund launched back in September, October of 2023. Significant income throughout this time period. But let's jump here to the fund overview and investment objectives. So this is an actively managed fund that seeks to generate monthly income by selling or writing call options on coin. CONY pursues a strategy that aims to harvest compelling yields while retaining capped participation in the price gains of coin. And we're going to break down how the mechanics of that work. The fund's primary investment objective is to seek current income. Their secondary investment objective is to seek exposure to the share price of the common stock of Coinbase Global, or COIN, subject to a limit on potential investment gains. Here's that inception date, August 14th, 2023, and the current price, or the net asset value, is $11.31 per share. They do have a gross expense ratio right now of 0.99%. To understand the mechanics of how this investment works, we need to look at the prospectus where it lays it out for us. They've got all their ETFs listed here, but all of the mechanics for all the ETFs happens to be the same. So let's dive in. Let's go down here to principal investment strategy. So synthetic exposure to underlying security price returns. This is the very first reason why it's different than most investments. In a traditional covered call strategy, you would A, hold at least 100 shares of the underlying stock. And then for every 100 shares you own, you would then B, sell a covered call option that generates income. And how close you are with your strike price to the market price is going to determine how much income you generate. But here we're talking about what's known as a synthetic exposure, but it's not even like a poor man's covered call type of synthetic exposure, which we talk about on this channel. Here, it's purely synthetic. And the way they break that down is they, number one, purchase call option contracts on the underlying securities, which generally have 1 to 6 month terms and strike prices equal to the then current price. So in the case of coin, if the price is $230 per share, they would purchase call options at $230 per share is the strike price, right at the money, with a duration of 1 to 6 months. Now, by purchasing the call option, it means that any growth in the stock price, you are participating in that. As the price of the underlying stock goes up in value, so does the value of the call option. But to purchase these options, it costs money. Then secondly, we scroll down here, the second thing they do is they simultaneously sell put option contracts on its underlying security to help pay the premium of the purchased call option contracts on the underlying security. So when you purchase call options, the first thing we do, we talked about, you get unlimited upside potential. By also selling put options at the money, the same idea, you are also 100% participating in the downside exposure of the stock as well. So if the stock goes up by a lot, you make a lot of money. If the stock goes down by a lot, you get to participate in all of that downside risk as well. What this does when you have the call options and the put options, it creates this diagonal line, which is meant to mimic the type of exposure you would have by owning 100 shares of coin. Because if you think about it, you own 100 shares of coin, if the stock goes up, you participate in that. If the stock goes down, you get to participate in that downside exposure as well. So the synthetically doing it this way does have a time cap because these options have contract time frames, but at the same time, you are mimicking pretty consistently the amount of upside and downside risk. To illustrate this with coin, let me show you the option chain here. So let's assume that the market price is 155, okay? So we will first off purchase the 155 call option expiring in 102 days. Okay, so we'll just do one contract there. And then we'll also add a leg here and we will sell to open the put options. We bought the call option, we're gonna sell the put option. Same December 20th, same strike price. And if you look at that, the net cost here is $239 instead of $15,000 to the cost to buy 100 shares of coin. Instead, it would cost you a net debit of $239.30. Now, one thing I want to point to your attention to is right here. Maximum gain, unlimited. Maximum loss, $15,738, which is essentially your break-even cost of $157.38 of coin. So you have the exact same exposure as owning 100 shares by running this strategy. The problem is there's a time limit, right? If you just buy 100 shares of coin, there's no time limit. You can hold it for as long as you want to. You can sell it when you want to. Here, we have a time frame of December 20th, 2024. So they do this. They create this synthetic exposure to the underlying stock, and then they sell covered calls. And whenever you sell covered calls, you are capping your price appreciation in the stock at that specific strike price. And here's where they break that down in the prospectus here. Generating monthly income. Each fund sells call option contracts that are based on the value of its underlying security to generate income via option premiums. On a monthly basis, or more frequently, a fund will sell call option contracts on underlying security with expiration dates of approximately 1 month or less in the future at strike prices that are approximately 0 to 15% above the then current share price of the underlying security. These are known as out-of-the-money call options. So if the price is $155, they might sell it at $165 or $160 or $170, $175, somewhere in that range. That generates option income that is the main driver of income with this strategy. One thing that's also interesting here with that is also in their prospectus is they also have the opportunity, as laid out here in the prospectus, that they have this opportunistic credit call spread strategy. So in other words, instead of utilizing the traditional covered call overlay on this synthetic approach, they have the option at times when they feel it's necessary, if they want to participate in more of the upside appreciation of the stock, they can do a call credit spread, which we actually talked about in a recent video, which is the idea that instead of just selling one call option, which caps your price and gives you income, instead you would sell a call option and also purchase a call option above that. So it actually gives you access to some more of the upside in the actual stock price. So the reason why their yield is so significant is this synthetic approach to owning the stock. So let's just say here, let me just add a leg just for the synthetic approach here. So let's just go ahead and sell to open. We'll just find a random call option here just so I can get a premium going here. Let's assume it's a 30-day option. So we'll go to, I don't know, 10.4. And let's assume 175, 170 right here. So that would generate you about $600. Okay, $600 at the 170 strike for 30 days. Now, I'm gonna get rid of that because it's gonna be confusing. So $600, and you divide that by the cost, which was $238 to have this long position, divided by $238, that's to get a yield of 250%. So this is why this has so much exposure. So I guess $600 is kind of crazy. Let's just assume it was $50 in premium. Okay, $50 in premium, normally, if you had to buy 100 shares of coin, it'd be $15,000. So you take 50, and you could do that 12 times a year, right? So it's monthly, so 50 times 12 is $600 annually, right? Divided by 15,500, that's only 3.87% yield. But if you can do that, right, with only $600, $1,000, $1,200, $2,000 in the actual underlying long position, instead of $15,500, you actually have, I don't know, $2,000, that yield pops up significantly because you put less capital at risk. So without further delay, let's dive into the spreadsheet. Let's take a look at the historical results for CONY. We'll compare it to, you know, just looking at the capital value as well as capital value plus distributions, aka total returns. We'll compare that to underlying changes in the actual stock, Coinbase, and then we'll look at the dividend income and have some key takeaways to draw upon. I'm assuming you're a $100,000 investment in CONY at the beginning of the period, not because you need to invest $100,000 to get any results, but because it was just to have a round number so you can see the meaningful differences in the actual changes in the stock price and the dividend income. So we've got CONY data here for $100,000. We've got CONY data at $1,000 capital investment, so I'll show you that too. The coin data, dividend income, and then there's this tab here I'm not going to go over right now. I'm going to talk about that in future. And then we've got graphs or the graph data as well. So if you started back on August 15th, 2023, and you bought $100,000 worth of CONY at $19.77 per share, okay, we scroll all the way down here to the bottom. At the end of the period, that $100,000 would only be worth $57,373.57, which is nearly a 60% drop. I guess it was nearly half, essentially. Now, again, that's just the capital value. That's not capital value plus the distributions, and the distributions are significant. So if you look at the lump sum total returns here, right here in capital in column AE, that $100,000 Yes, it dropped to 57, but you also generated, right over here, $104,071.80 in dividend or distribution income right here. So you add those numbers together, the total return is $161,445.37, which is more than $100,000, so it's very significant. But if you look at what the actual stock price for COIN started at $79.18, and during that same time frame, if you'd invested $100,000, that $100 would have grown to $186.94.97, but at times it was much higher than that, in the 300s. And just for your awareness here, if we're looking at the same investment, $1,000 capital value instead of $100,000, just to downsize the numbers for your awareness, that $1,000, like I said, with CONY, be worth what, $573.74 right here. The total return was $1,614.45, because during that same time frame, despite the investment dropping from $1,000 to $573, you generated $1,040.72 in premium. In other words, you generated more premium than the actual capital value than you invested. Here's a look at that data. So we've got three different lines here. We've got in pink, we've got the actual capital value of CONY. Okay, so if you invest $100,000 with the high yield investment, it went from 100 down to 57 right here. Then we have the green line, which is the total return for CONY, which is the capital value plus all of the distributions. That's the green line right here along the way. Then you got the red line. You can see that COIN was actually pretty volatile. It jumped from 100 up to 230, down to 150, up to 350, down to 275 here-ish, up again to nearly 325, and then down to where it's at right now, which is 186. Here's the same view, but at the $1,000 capital value level. I didn't include COIN here, but we've got the $1,000 invested, which dropped to 573 in the capital value. And then if you look up here, we've got the total return, which is right around, 1614, I believe. Here's a look at the dividend income for 100,000 and for 1,000. So just to give you an idea here, there were 12 distributions during that time frame, ranging from as low as 101 per share up to as high as 279 per share. Quite a bit of volatility there. And you can see that at $100,000 capital, there was quite a bit of income being generated, but there's also a lot of volatility. Same thing here, it's just the same numbers, but downsized based on $1,000 in capital. Here's a look at that same data, but graphed together with the price. So you can see that as prices were going up, distributions were going up. And then as prices dropped, distributions went down. Same thing, popped back up, distributions went up, down, and then distributions went down. So what first thing this tells me is that out of the gate, they were a little bit too liberal with their distribution policies. They probably should have withheld or held on to a lot more of that income and had a more stable distribution amount. So instead of distributing $2 per share, $2.50, if they'd stuck right around $1.75 right here and reinvested all this income into the underlying stock, they might have had much better results. Speaking of which, let's go ahead and take a look and see if they had how much of the income would you have had to reinvest to keep your value at $100,000 during this time frame? So going back over to the CONY data, let me scroll to the top, whenever we received a distribution, we had reinvested a specific percentage of capital back into the underlying ETF, and instead of holding on to the distributions, how would that have affected the overall price? How stable can we make CONY by reinvesting some of this capital? So let's start with 25. Let's assume for every dollar we're receiving, we're reinvesting 25 cents. So right here, you can see that's 1530 being reinvested, 4591 being kept. Scroll all the way down here to the bottom. You can see that at the end of the day, instead of receiving only 104,000 distributions, we would receive a total of 115. But we only got to keep 86,000 of that instead of 104,000, or all of it over here. So the net value here, instead of being 57,000 for our capital, was 71. I mean, I guess that's great, but not great really when you're giving up that much income. Let's actually scroll back up here, and we'll change it from 25 to 40%. So for every dollar, we reinvest 40 cents, we keep 60 cents. Let's scroll all the way down here to the very bottom. We can see right here. So total distributions we received instead of 104 was actually 123. We got to keep 73,000 of it. And at the end of the day here, instead of being worth 57,000 under the original scenario, it's worth 81. That's pretty good. One last situation we'll look at. Instead, let's reinvest 50%. Okay, actually, let's make it, 50% here. I can't justify reinvesting more than I'm actually taking. So let's just say here, for every dollar, we keep half in distributions, the other half gets reinvested. So at the end of the day, so all the way down during this time frame, instead of receiving 104,000, we receive 128,000 distributions. And during that time frame, we get to keep $64,000. Now that's plenty of income, right? And at the end of the day, our $100,000 is worth 88,000. that's pretty good. It's not 100, for sure. In fact, just to give you that actual break-even number that would get you to 100,000, let's just assume we reinvest, I don't know, 57%? Does that do it? Nope. Let's try 61%. Gets us pretty close here at $97,000. So, but that, again, that means you're giving up for every dollar, 57 cents is going back into the fund, 43 cents is being kept, but you're getting taxed on all of it unless this is in a retirement account, for the record. And that income, by the way, would be $52,000. So you still have an income that you can live on, but again, you're giving up a lot of income in exchange. So my key takeaways here when looking at the actual data, really what it comes down to is I cannot foresee any situation where I would want to use this type of investment for long-term capital gains, right? The idea of I'm saving in my retirement account for and using this investment makes no sense. I would rather use the S&P 500, use the NASDAQ 100, something that's much more balanced with respect to capital appreciation as opposed to income now. It's just too volatile. The synthetic exposure can come in to bite you pretty bad if the stock goes down significantly. It just makes no sense for somebody who doesn't need any income at all or is looking to save long-term for the future. If you're looking to save money, if you're looking to grow a nest egg for the future, makes no sense at all, for the record. But I could see a potential use here where you take, let's say you have a fixed expense, right? Let's say a car for $20,000. And instead of giving up $20,000 in capital, you get a car loan and you take a fixed investment of, let's say, I don't know what exactly the number would be, maybe $4,000 or $5,000 of CONY, and that pays for your car for you. So you have an auto loan, and yes, you have debt, but at the same time, you have some capital, some asset that is working on your behalf to create that income that pays for that debt, that car. I could see a use there, and I might explore that a little bit to see what that would look like and maybe even test it out on my own, just because I'm always curious to see how things work out in real life. If you guys think I missed something about CONY, or if there's other aspect of this you want me to talk more about in the future, any specific test you want me to do as well, make sure to leave that down in the description below. Also, this spreadsheet, if you want access to it, is available to all members of the Average Joe Investor Patreon community, so make sure you check out that link down in the description below. You can get access to spreadsheets, access to an amazing Average Joe Investor DIY cash flow investor community. So if you want to learn more, check out the link down in the description below. Make sure to leave your 2 cents down in the comments below. It's my goal to respond to as many of these comments as possible on the day I post a new video. That's all I got for you guys. Have a great rest of your day, and thanks for watching.